What's going on, guys? The Comics Kid 2099 here to examine an issue of the X-Men. Today, I will be examining X-Men issue 38. If you watched my video on issue 37, I suspected that issue 38 would be the conclusion to the Factor 3 storyline. I really didn't think that this story had very much room to move much further. I figured everything would kind of wrap up here. As of this issue, it looks like we may spend another 3 issues on this. I don't know. This issue both gives me hope and also kind of fills my heart with dread, because starting here, we have the beginning of a pretty lengthy backup storyline in this series, where we examine the origins of the X-Men, and how they came to meet Professor Xavier before the events of issue 1. So the actual story of the X-Men trying to stop the mutant master of Factor 3 from blowing up all of humanity, that only takes about 16 or 17 pages, and then there's another 3 or 4 pages of Professor X discovering that the FBI is now investigating the mutant menace, and then he wants to get in on that action and kind of help the mutants and help the FBI learn that not all mutants are bad. So the Factor 3 storyline is going to be extended because the entire issue is not going to be devoted to the Factor 3 storyline. And in theory, I know I haven't credited anyone who worked on this yet. I'll get to that in a minute. But in theory, I'm kind of on board with this, because when you look at the 60s at Marvel, some of my favorite stuff are the series where the entire issue is actually two separate stories. You look at Captain America, the Hulk, the Doctor Strange stories. Most of the time, those characters were sharing a series with another character. So Doctor Strange was sharing Strange Tales at first with the Human Torch, and then later with Nick Fury. And then Captain America had Tales of Suspense that I think he was sharing with Iron Man. The Hulk was sharing Tales to Astonish at one point with Namor, and then later with Giant Man. And so they didn't have to fluff out a 10-page plot with 10 more pages of useless nonsense, as you've been seeing in these Silver Age X-Men issues. If they only had 10 pages of plot, then they would do 10 pages of plot. And then the other pages of the issue would go to another character. And so it is much easier to go back and read Silver Age Captain America, Silver Age Hulk, or Silver Age Doctor Strange than it is to read these Silver Age X-Men issues. Starting now, we are going to be devoting about 1/3 of the issue, or 1/4 of the issue, to these flashback stories, but unfortunately, it looks like we are still going to be stretching this storyline that should have only been 4 or 5 stories or issues long into a 15-20 part story when it really didn't need to be. So I am both interested in seeing the pacing of these issues kind of go a little faster in theory, because you're going to have fewer pages to work with, so the story is going to be gotten into a little faster in each issue, but also that means it's going to take a lot longer for us to get done with all this mess. So the first part of this issue is everything I think is edited by Stan Lee. Both stories are written by Roy Thomas. Don Heck does the penciling in the first story with inks by George Bell, and the lettering by L.P. Gregory, who is a name I had never heard of before, so I Googled him, and that was a pseudonym. This is actually Gaspar Saladino, and if you have never heard of him, you have definitely heard of comics that he has worked on. He worked on some Bronze Age Swamp Thing. He did the lettering on Arkham Asylum by Grant Morrison and Sam Keith. That's probably the biggest thing that he's known for. He died a few years ago. I had never heard of him either in this pseudonym or with his real name, but he's worked on some pretty important comics over the years. And then the backup issue, also written by Roy Thomas, with pencils by Werner Roth. He's back again. I don't know if he's going to be just staying in the backup issues for a while, or if he's going to be returning to the main focus of the Factor 3 storyline, but he's back in this issue, in this backup story, with inks by, I had to write this one down, John Verporten. I've never heard of him before, and lettering by Sam Rosen. So quite a bit to unpack in this issue. Like I said, said, Factor 3, more specifically the Mutant Master, is wanting to exterminate all of humanity with this complicated plot where he wants to trick the Soviet Union and the United States of America into going to war with each other. And so the X-Men, they escape from the Factor 3 headquarters. Beast apparently was able to sense with his bare feet that there was a bomb in the building, and he warns everyone the building's about to explode. So they get out in two of these little flying saucer things, and it appears the flying saucers cannot be remote driven. In one of the previous issues, Cyclops, I think it was it might have been the issue before, Cyclops, he exploded one of those, and he briefly mourned that he didn't want to actually destroy it, but he had no choice. And I wasn't even sure if anyone was actually on board or if they were just remote controlling it, but in this issue the X-Men are actually flying these things inside the little saucers, so it looks like maybe they can't be remote controlled. I'm not really sure, but anyway, apparently Beast can just sense a bomb with his feet. That's a power that he has never displayed before, nor will he ever display again that I'm aware of. But anyway, they go back to headquarters, and then I was mistaken. Apparently Mastermind, Vanisher, Blob, and Eunice the Untouchable are actually working for Factor 3. I mentioned in the trial of the X-Men by Factor 3 that these guys were probably just put on a conference call to laugh at the X-Men, and then they could go about their lives. But they are actually working for the Mutant Master. And so Cyclops and Iceman, they go to an American military base so that they can convince the general, hey, someone is going to try and launch nuclear missiles from this base. And I just read the issue. I don't remember how the X-Men find out that it's that specific military base, because there are a lot of military bases in America, and I don't think the Mutant Master actually told them which specific military base that he was going to be using. He just told them that America and the Soviet Union would be going to war with each other. But then Angel, Jean Grey, and Beast, they go to the Soviet Union to try and disarm the bomb that's going to blow up, and the Soviet Union will think that the Americans did this. And Cyclops even tells the Americans at the military base he's at, if you don't let us look for the Factor 3 agent here, then we will destroy these nuclear weapons, which that is insane. That is the most insane thing that has happened in any of these comics so far. Up until now, humans have been kind of 50-50 on hating on mutants. Sometimes we see that they really hate mutants, and sometimes they seem to be A-okay with them. There was one issue where a mob formed to try and, I guess, lynch the Beast whenever he saved a kid. That was way back in the first Eunice the Untouchable issue. And then just a couple of issues ago, we had a construction worker who was willing to give the X-Men a job, except that they weren't part of a union, and that was going to give him some trouble with a union and stuff like that. I don't know the rules. Sometimes humans seem to really hate mutants, and sometimes they don't. This, the X-Men threatening to destroy nuclear weapons, and then both in the Soviet Union and in America, the X-Men get captured, and Jean or Angel even says they think that we were here as spies from America. So both sides of the country, or both countries here, both sides of the Iron Curtain, they think that these mutants are a huge threat. And I think it would be really great if, from this point forward, if the X-Men were seen as public enemy number one because of this. I'm 99% sure that's not going to happen. We have quite a ways to go before mutants will consistently be seen as a threat. So I don't think that they are going to be seen as these guys who tried to destroy a nuclear base, so they need to be arrested on site or shot on site or whatever anytime in the future. But we will often see instances where the X-Men are blamed for stuff that they didn't do. In fact, just a couple of issues ago, the one with Meccano, he accused the X-Men of being his allies. And you see that kind of stuff a lot in this series, but then very rarely does it actually play out and mean anything. I remember Count Nefaria, he had these holograms of the X-Men being his allies, even though they weren't. So that's happened a couple of times, but this feels like the stakes are high. This feels like the only time where I could easily see it continuing to have a bearing on this series. Now, I'm pretty sure it doesn't, but reading this issue, it felt important. It felt like this was a big deal, and I like that. Once again, I was kind of off base with the agents of Factor 3 helping the X-Men. I mentioned that the Vanisher, Blob, Eunice, and the Mastermind, that some of those guys seemed like they wouldn't want to see all of humanity get destroyed because, you know, these guys are the types of guys who would steal from a bank, and what good is money if there's no one to give money to and get stuff from. But in this issue, like I said, they are actually working for Factor 3. Apparently, they are all A-okay with destroying humanity. At one point, Changeling, he is thinking, wait a minute, the Mutant Master probably wants to turn us into his slaves after he destroys humanity. And he says, the only reason that we even join the Mutant Master was because humanity hates us. And so, it does look like there is going to be a little bit of betrayal here. The Beast, Angel, and Jean Grey, they are in jail with the Blob in the Soviet Union. And Beast even says, well, we can't get out of this jail, but the Blob can. So maybe we're going to still see some villains working with heroes a little bit here. I'm getting a strong Starscream Megatron vibe from Changeling and the Mutant Master. And this was like, you know, 15 years before the Transformers was even a thing. So that's a little interesting with the Changeling kind of scheming behind the Mutant Master's back. Not so much to take over the organization, although he does kind of think about maybe he's going to try and depose the Mutant Master once humanity has been destroyed, but mostly he's just doing what he does, or thinking about doing what he does, out of self-preservation. So that's about it in the front half of this issue. Then you get to the little five-page Cyclops origin, and Cyclops is barely here. This one is weird. So we start off in the school. It talks about there is a secret room that must remain locked, and then when you go in there, there are all these filing cabinets, and it kind of looks like if you're my age or a little older, when you used to go into a library and they had the card catalog, it looks a lot like that. And it says, within these drawers, there's lots of information. Sometimes it's trivial information. Okay, if this is such a secretive locked room, why is there trivial information in here? But then it says, we're not going to start our story in this room. Why? I don't even understand why I even show the locked room, and it says there's information about the origins of the X-Men. Okay, in the school, you have the origins of the X-Men written down on paper, and you've got it in a locked room that nobody, including the X-Men, are allowed to look at. Why? Why is Cyclops not allowed to look at that one time that Professor Xavier recruited him? That's so weird. So bizarre. So anyway, then we cut to the FBI's headquarters, and Fred Duncan, who we have seen maybe twice in this series, he showed up back in issue 2, and there's a little footnote reminding us of that. He is Professor Xavier's contact within the FBI. Him and another guy, I don't even think they say his name at any point, they are watching a television report of the Mutant Menace, and we find out that it's Cyclops. Basically, Cyclops accidentally blasted this thing that was on a crane. It was a very large air conditioning unit. He accidentally blasted the cord, so then the unit was about to fall on the crowd. Then he blasted the unit again so that it wouldn't crush the crowd. But here's the weird thing about that. The FBI is watching that on TV, and you know that it's on TV and it's not being projected on the wall, because one of them actually reaches over and turns off the knob on the TV. And then one of them says, we better start investigating this Mutant Menace. Then the other one says, okay, but we better tell the newspapers about this. And so then Professor Xavier is at his house, and he sees the headline of a newspaper that says, the Mutant Menace. And he says, oh no. So then he goes to the FBI so that he can say, hey, can I help you guys? Maybe the mutants will be more receptive to me, also a mutant, than they will be to you. Getting some strong vibes from X-Men First Class here, where there was a very similar conversation there. And also, there's a scene that very much reminds me of X-Men Apocalypse, where Beast and Xavier go in to talk to Maury McTaggart, and he basically mind controls everyone so that they don't see him and they don't remember him. He does that here in this issue. But anyway, there's some weird continuity here with Professor X of stuff up until this point, because Professor X is in a wheelchair here, and he says after his brother Kane, his stepbrother Kane, touched the Crimson Gem of Sidorak, or Sidorak, Xavier basically went into self-imposed exile. We know that that's not true, because we have seen flashbacks already of Professor Xavier fighting Lucifer, who is an alien, who crushed Xavier's spine. And that did not happen before the Korean War. Xavier was up and walking when Juggernaut touched the gem. So we know that the Lucifer thing happened after Kane touched the gem. But this completely ignores the Lucifer thing and says that Xavier went into hiding after Kane touched the gem, and he was hoping he could just stay away from the population, but then he sees that the mutants are going to be hunted down by the FBI, so he has to do something to protect both the mutants and the humans. And This is also really weird that Professor Xavier is basically just hoping for the best. He knows about mutants. He knows that he is a mutant. He knows there are other mutants out there. Much later on, we will see retcons that he has encountered at least two or three other mutants before he was put in his wheelchair. Amelia Vogt, I don't know how to say her name, but Professor Xavier's girlfriend, who later became an acolyte. Magneto, he obviously met before he founded the X-Men. The Shadow King, he briefly met young Storm. He briefly met young Jean Grey, and then she pretended like she had never met him whenever you get to X-Men issue 1. So he has met many mutants before this moment, but then he's acting like, well, I just wanted to hide away from the world, but that's no longer an option. That's a very bizarre interpretation of Xavier that I don't think I've seen anywhere else before, except for in the miniseries First X-Men by Neil Adams, which and Christos Gage, which is an astoundingly awful story. Don't ever read that, but that story actually has Wolverine, of all people, form the first team of X-Men, and then he kind of guilt trips Xavier, and so by the end of that story, Xavier's like, yeah, I think I'm going to make something out of my life. So I guess that was kind of calling back to this issue. But anyway, not a whole lot happens here, except I want to get back to what I was saying about the FBI watching that on TV. They're watching it on TV, and then they say, we need to tell the newspapers about this. And then the newspaper gets to Xavier, and then Xavier says, well, now mutants are a known entity. Everyone knows about mutants now because of this newspaper. It was on TV. And then later, Xavier, he sneaks into the FBI headquarters, and now the FBI guys are watching it on a projector. For any of you younger than me, a projector is when you had this thing called film, and then you could project it on a wall. And they're watching it on a projector now. It would have made more sense if they were watching it on a projector before, because if they were watching it on TV, and you actually see them turn the knob on the wall, so it is on a TV. If they were watching it on TV, I'm assuming that Xavier would have seen it on TV if he has a TV, if he watches TV, but I'm assuming everyone would have already known because of the TV announcement. You wouldn't need to see it in the newspapers also. The newspapers would have already been reporting on this. They wouldn't need the FBI to clue them in on their own investigation. Also, since when do the FBI go to the newspaper and say, this is what we are investigating? These are the agents that we're putting on this. That's really weird. So not a whole lot of Cyclops in this one. It said Origins of the X-Men. I guess technically it's the origins of Professor X getting ready to form the X-Men. But I'm hoping that later issues will kind of do more of an even split of Factor 3 stuff in the present day and Origin stuff in the past. Because I'd kind of like to see them get through these origins. I know there's only 5 X-Men right now, but at this rate, it's going to take like 15 issues to get through all of the origins of the X-Men, and I would like to see them get through that a little faster. But I guess if they did that, then it would take even longer to get through the Factor 3 stuff. So that's about it for this issue. This was a really long video. Hopefully, starting with my next video, it won't take me quite as long to get through both stories. But that is about it. So consider this issue examined.